One of the nine diagrams of UMLs are the use case diagrams. Basically, these are, I will not say that important, but I'll say very important, and I will rather say compulsory diagrams needed for software projects. So basically, first we'll try to understand that where basically these diagrams are needed in the software life cycle. So as we all know these phases, but I will just iterate through it. The requirement phase, where we basically take the requirement from the customer. The design phase, which actually defines the technical roadmap of how our execution or coding should take place. The build phase, where exactly the coding is done or execution is done. Testing, either it's a UAT, acceptance level testing by the customer, or probably it's an internal testing. But all kind of testing will fall in the testing phase, and then finally delivery, and then we move towards the maintenance phase. Use case diagrams or use cases are used in the requirement phase. They are used basically to collect requirements from the customer, and then these use cases are then fed into the design phase to define the technical roadmap. So basically, use case diagrams answer what will the system do. So basically, it will tell, okay, that my system has a invoicing system, and it does printing of invoices. It probably updates my invoices, adds new invoices, whatever it is. So it will only say what the system will do. That means that use cases or use case diagrams can be read by the business user. And because they've only defined what will the system do, so they are used mainly in the requirement documents to depict clarity regarding a system. So they are used in the requirement phase of the software life cycle. Now there are three important parts of a use case. The first very important part is the actor. The actor is the who of the system. In other words, he is the end user. Then we have the use case, the task or the goal. For example, here the actor will be actually log in. He wants to log into the chat system. So basically, the simple chat user is our actor, and login is a use case. One important part about use cases is that basically they represent actions in strong verbs. So for example, you can see on your slide that login is a verb. It's an action performed by the chat user. So and the whole thing is called as the scenario. So these are the three aspects or three important things when we write any use case. Now, in actors, we have two types of actors. One is the primary actor and the other is the secondary actor. Primary actors are the users who are active participants. They initiate the use case. For instance, let's say that the account, let's say that this is a simple requirement where the accountant logs into the invoicing system and he prints the invoice, he or she prints the invoice, and the runner boy, or I'll say rather the office boy, he takes up the invoice and goes to the end customer to actually deliver the invoice and take money. So we have three actors in this. One is the accountant, one is the runner boy, or I'll say the office boy, and the customer. But the primary actor is the accountant, because he or she has actually printed the invoice. They have initiated the actions, and later on the other actors followed it. So depending on what the use case is, the actors can be primary and secondary. For example, if we say that, okay, the runner boy, for instance, if I say, okay, the office boy basically goes and delivers the goods or delivers the invoice. If you say from that perspective, then the office boy becomes a primary actor. So depending on what the use case is or what the action is, the actors can change from primary to secondary and secondary to primary. So depending on what the use case is, the actors level vary. So an actor who is a primary actor in one of the use cases can be a secondary actor in the other use case. But yes, the primary and secondary actors are important aspects when we are important things which we should note when we write use cases or when we draw the use case diagrams. Use case can have two views of presentation, and it's very important to have these two views when you two views of presentation in requirement document, because one shows the higher level view while the other shows the detail and nitty-gritty. So One is the use case diagram. For example, this is a diagram, you know, where you have a simple user, then you have an admin user, then, you know, the simple user can add a simple customer, while the admin user can add a discounted customer. And whenever the simple customer is added, you need to send an email. Well and good and nice and nice. From the overall point of view, you have come to know that the various use cases and the various actors. But now, you also want to know that what is the detailed steps involved in completing this use case. So that is done by the use case tables. So in the use case tables, what we do is that we take up a use case, for example, login. Okay, we give a description to it. We define who are the primary actors. We define preconditions. We define the trigger, how the use case will be initiated. We define the assumptions, fail conditions. We define our action, and then we define in detail steps about how this action will take place. For example, here's a login action. So the user types the URL on the browser. He enters a username. He selects the rooms. He does this. He does that. So you can have a two-level view in a requirement document: the diagram and then the table. So in this way, anybody who is actually reading a requirement document can really understand, you know, really get the overall picture also, and also he can get the detailed view. So if he is not convinced by the overall picture, he can probably go into the detailed view and try to read more about the use case. The other very important thing about use cases are that, you know, they define relationships. You know, they depict the relationships during requirement gathering. In the previous slides or in the previous things which we have derived from use cases are that, you know, we have identified the actors, we have identified what kind of use cases or actions are, but now in the real world there are relationships between the use cases and the actors. So these are depicted by include and extend. Okay, let's see what exactly it means. Basically, include defines invocation. Okay, it defines using factor. Let me give this sentence to you. You know, Shiv is a father of Sanjana. Okay, and Shiv is a father of Sanjana, and Shiv has a Titan watch. Okay, now there are two important keywords to be noted in both of these sentences. The first sentence is Shiv is a father of Sanjana, is a relationship, parent-child relationship. So that is depicted by extend in use cases. So for example, admin is a type of simple user. So this is called as a is a relationship, or we can say generalization specialization relationship. We'll come into the class diagrams to understand what is generalization specialization, but over here just remember that this is extend, or this relationship in real world is defined using extend. Now the second statement, Shiv has a Titan watch. So basically I have no parent-child relationship with the Titan watch, so but I am using and then probably just keeping it in the evening, you know, on the sofa or on the table. So in the sense, you know, it is not something that the Titan watch has my properties of my hair, or, you know, but I'm using it because I need to see the time, but then I'm just, you know, my relationship is of a has a relationship. So add simple customer has a relationship of sending has a relationship with a send email use case. So this is more of invocation relationship, and that is depicted by using include. So has a relationship is depicted by using include, while is a relationship is depicted by using extend. Remember, when we do requirement gathering, you know, the one of the very important points, two important things should definitely come out of any requirement. First, what are the nouns and verbs which we have already done in the previous section, where we said, okay, the nouns are nothing but your actors and the verbs are nothing but your use cases. But again, these nouns and these actors have a relationship between them, you know.